everyone. I am Kritika Rashi, and it is with great pleasure that I welcome you
all to the Spring 2015 edition of the I-MACX Summit and Demo Day. We are glad to see all of you here. To formally inaugurate the event, we will now have the traditional lighting of the lamp. I request our chief guest, Dr. Pramod Varma, to join Professor Balaji here. I would also like to request one of our panelists and one of the IMAX startups to come forward to light the lamp. Can I request one of the students to join here, please? For getting this event started. I now invite Professor Balaji, Dean Faculty of IIIT Bangalore, to welcome the gathering.
It gives me great pleasure to invite all of you to IIIT-B on this occasion, which is very special in a sort of way in the evolution of this institution. While IIIT has always unabashedly been a research institution, of course, with its fair share of teaching to train the next generation of researchers. We've never been a research institution that has followed the traditional ivory tower model. The institution has, from day one, reached out to other stakeholders, partners in the environment that contributes to research. And this includes the state, although we are not a state institution at all. To industry and to the not-for-profit sector, in the firm belief that research is best done when we bring together or highlight the combinatorial possibilities that exist and bring together the strengths, the capabilities that are available in these different sectors so that the whole is greater than the sum of the parts. Okay, and that's really been the philosophy of this institution from day one. Okay, I think the institute can take justifiable pride in being among the first to set up an innovation center, perhaps not the first in the country, but if you look at it in terms of where it started in the institute's own history, okay, the innovation center came off the bat very quickly. By the end of our second year, we had the first company that was sort of incubated in this institute. And by the end of the fifth year, if I'm fifth or the sixth year perhaps, we had an innovation center that was up and running. Okay, and since then we've had quite a few share of companies that have come out. Right, so that's always been very central to the sort of the pursuit of research and ideas at this institute. And to me, the emergence of the IMAX center is just another sort of logical step in the sort of the institute's evolution. A step that brings together research that's done at the institute, our students, a fine set of entrepreneurs and their ideas, and of course with government backing, because this is the original idea came with some support from the state of Karnataka, which we must acknowledge, and a number of other sort of people who have supported this venture, in terms of people who provided funding, other forms of support, and so on, for achieving social goals. So you have the state, you have academia, you have you have entrepreneurs, you have the corporate sector coming together to achieve social goals, right? And this also fits in with some other things that have been happening at the institute. For instance, we have started for the first time again in this country a new MSc program in what we call the digital society, which attempts to bring together technical skills with the intellectual rigor that's necessary to contribute to providing solutions, products, and services for a variety of social problems that confront our society. So in a sense, what we're seeing here today is, like I mentioned earlier, part of the evolution of this institute. And it's wonderful to see you all here today, being a part of this occasion. And I would like to sort of, at this stage, thank once again, first of all the entrepreneurs and their ideas, this the first graduating class of the I-MACX, if I may call it that, or the others who sort of supported this initiative, the state of Karnataka, and a number of others who are here in the audience, many of whom I don't know personally, I must admit. Mr. Pramod Varma for coming here to sort of be the chief guest today. All the panelists who are going to be taking part in the discussion. And of course, one cannot but avoid a word of appreciation to Ramesh, Srikanth, and Jagdish for translating what is even 6 to 8 months ago nothing more than a concept into reality. So it's a sort of a historic afternoon of sorts at IIIITB, and I hope this sets the trend for many more exciting sort of possibilities in terms of ideas that come out. Whether they become commercial successes or not, it's not the point. But the thing is, the whole point of an academic institute is to be this melting pot of ideas, to kind of churn through things, to think about issues in new ways that we've not. And that's the kind of platform that IIIITB wants to be and will continue to offer for people from different walks of life. Thank you, and I wish this afternoon all success.
Thank you, sir. I would now request Professor T.K. Srikanth to talk about the IMAX initiative and the objectives of the summit.
Good afternoon. A very warm welcome to all of you. It's so wonderful to see a large crowd here. Special welcome to our chief guests, our panelists, all the mentors who helped us, and all of you have been here. As Professor Balaji just said, this is a part of an ongoing set of initiatives we have to where we're trying to bring together like-minded people from government, social sector, startups, and other enthusiasts to help highlight opportunities, challenges in the civic tech space. We have, as I'll talk about briefly, we have a larger agenda we are trying to drive, and this is a very focused part of that agenda. And we are seeing how all these different stakeholders can work together, this ecosystem can work together to make a greater impact in the civic tech and the larger social space. So we have focused this acceleration program. The summit is the culmination of the first I-MACX acceleration program, which started 3 months back. And for this summit, we're trying to focus on how technologies related to the mobile, IoT, cloud, and etc. can be leveraged to create interesting solutions, impactful solutions. And specifically, if you look at the mobile technologies and related technologies, the benefits and the promise, I would say, of these technologies, how do we make sure that they extend to a larger set of developers and a larger set of beneficiaries who can get the benefits of that? So when we started this 3 months back, we talked about how the mobile revolution has been growing and how we are looking at how that should be best leveraged. Clearly, this is a set of technologies that allows solutions to reach a large audience geographically, in terms of demographics, in terms of other cuts that you can take. And so I don't think there's any question anymore whether this can play a role or not in the society and the development of society. It's only a question of when and how best we can make it happen. So the I-MACX initiative specifically is one step in enabling such developments. This started off with the Government of Karnataka 2020 vision idea, which said that how can we make mobile application development a much larger enterprise, much larger initiative in Karnataka, and how do we jumpstart the entrepreneurial ecosystem around mobile apps? There's no reason why it should be restricted to large companies, medium companies, companies only in Bangalore, or anything like that. So that was the sort of the starting point. And based on that, we set up a set of initiatives within IIIT. We set up what we call the Mobile Application Center of Excellence, which looks at two or three broad themes. One is, as an institute, as an educational institute, how can we enable mobile application development among hundreds and thousands of startups, individual developers, startups, etc., across the towns and cities and villages of Karnataka. The second is looking at how this technology can be leveraged best. How do we extend it to organizations, population groups, problem areas that are today underserved by these technologies? A large percentage of apps we see are enterprise apps aimed at consumers, aimed more at more affluent sections of society. So we are looking at what about apps that have social relevance that can help in the areas of governance, healthcare, education, agriculture, and areas like that. And as an institute, can we enable civic social organizations and developers work together to take the benefits of these technologies to a larger thing, and help people who are underserved, disadvantaged by location, age, disabilities, education, income levels, and so on. How do we make sure that the whole mobile revolution doesn't create a sharper digital divide in some sense? So specifically what we have looked at is, as a starting point, so this whole initiative in some form is about a year old, but most of it, like Professor Balaji mentioned, is about 6 months old. One is what we like to do best is training courses for our students. They do both classes and projects which involve developing applications which have a social theme. The intention is to take this to a larger audience, take it outside the institute and set up training and certification programs that can be much larger. We have set up a test lab here that will help test mobile applications. One of the challenges in rolling out mobile applications is testing it on a diverse set of devices, operating systems, network conditions, and so on. And then we are building up a center where we're focusing on socially relevant apps. And as part of that, we work with government organizations, NGOs, social organizations, many others, looking at problems that they are facing or that they believe could be solved with better use of mobile technology, working with students, startups, and others to help create these things. And the process also study issues that come up in the development of such applications. There are issues that could be specific to the user groups being targeted, the phone types being targeted, the kind of data being collected, and you know, trying to build a better understanding of this whole space through that. And the other part is, you know, as we already have this incubation center, as part of that now we have launched the acceleration program, specifically targeting startups who are also more or less aligned with this vision and this focus area. And the IMAX acceleration is the first of the sessions we have had around that. And you know, our intention is to develop these applications either within the institute or in partnership with some of the organizations. And develop commercialization or deployment partnerships with startups and other companies to actually take these solutions out and make them actually, you know, usable and have an impact. So we have an IIITB Innovation Center under which we have an incubation center which has been running for many years. Some of the companies you'll meet today are already running as part of that. And the accelerator program is a part of that. It's been driven by Professor Ramesh Sundaraman, who generally stays in the background but does all the work. And what we have done is put together a network of mentors, trainers, professors, advisors, and so on, who have actually been working with this first batch of companies, helping them shape their ideas, shape their business plans, shape their product plans, and so on, to help them get to the next stage. And later in the afternoon, we'll see actual presentations and pitch from all of them. So in this batch, we had 6 companies go through this program, along with 3 others who are already in incubation. The companies we'll hear from today are AppSimple, Clytex, Easy M2M, Kisan Sati, Online RTI, Query Home, and along with Chipmunk, RedMed, and Srishti ESDM. We would like to congratulate this batch of companies to having gone through this. We wish them all the best in their entrepreneurial journey, and you know, hopefully they'll be very successful, impactful, and household names in a year or so. So that's the context, and you know, we will later in the program get deeper into what the companies themselves have done. At this point, what I'd like to do is get our chief guest on to give his keynote address. It's a pleasure to welcome. It's a pleasure to welcome Dr. Pramod Varma as our chief guest and keynote speaker today. So he asked me to keep his introduction very brief. It is, you know, it can go on for some time, but Dr. Pramod Varma works as chief architect and technology to the UIDAI, the Aadhaar project, and sits on the advisory board of a few startups and mentors and provides technology and architecture direction to them. He's been working on Aadhaar since the beginning. He was the chief architect at UIDAI, responsible for the entire system architecture and strategic technology decisions. He joined the organization in 2009 and has been pivotal in ensuring an open, scalable, and secure architecture built to meet the needs of the Aadhaar project. He holds a master's and PhD degree in computer science, along with a second master's in applied mathematics. And his main interests are in distributed architectures, web technologies, intelligent systems, and is passionate about technology, science, society, and teaching. So it's with great pleasure that I welcome him to start his keynote speech.
Okay, thanks for having me. I find it very odd, actually, all this formality, okay? So I'm a techie at heart, and I find it, I can't even sit here. I actually find it very odd. I wasn't sure what I was supposed to speak. Actually, I wasn't sure at all. I was supposed to catch up with Dr. Sridhar. It never happened. When I came in and said I work for Aadhaar, I'm the chief architect, I built the technology, said, oh, looking forward to hearing that. I said, oh, I wasn't planning to speak on Aadhaar because I think the title was something else, right? Using technology platforms. So I tried to put together few slides that is relevant to what I am doing in the last 5 years. And I think it should be useful, especially considering the social impactful project you are doing. And without the government system, these are incomplete. And you will find it very hard as a startup to succeed in a silo, succeed in your own world. And it won't be interoperable. People won't have choice. Whether you're doing healthcare, you know, those healthcare startups and so on, you have to eventually plug into a larger highway. And I think the only government can really provide that. And government should provide that. I think I'm going to speak few of that. I want to leave a few ideas about technology because it said platform, and I don't think people really fully understand, especially in the government. I don't think they understand what a platform means, and it's not a natural thinking at all for inside traditional apps. And we also come from a services mindset. So we built all the IT as services and not necessarily as products. So product companies find it very hard. And all of us who've been in 20-25 years in the product industry, now when we look at the youngsters trying to build products in India, especially in the government, they are unknown for the whole system. They don't exist. They find it very hard to compete. Okay, so I'm going to talk about few things that I think can change the way government can work and how they should be building systems that allows startups and product innovations to happen. Okay, so I'm going to give few examples of that, how we have been working in the last few years, and hopefully people who are influencing in the government or as a tech, when you represent to the system, larger system, you have a common way of articulating what you are expecting them to do versus what you are expected to do. So if you look at the typical system, I mean, government systems are, you know, crazy complex, right? Lots of forms, lots of supporting documents, lots of signatures. Nobody really knows why people take all those signatures, and nobody can even figure it out. And in fact, I just spoke with Professor Sadra at IIIT Bombay. He was like IBI, RBI connected person, right? He gave his electronic mandate to SBI. Once upon a time, okay, and he says that was the biggest mistake of his life. And then he gave it to Vodafone, saying that you can actually charge me. I mean, automatically it looked nice, but after a few months, and he wanted to actually change, he wanted to cancel. So he went to SBI and said, I want to cancel, revoke the automated, electronic mandate. I want to cancel it. They said, we don't know how to cancel it. We can't even figure out where the paper is. So he kept asking, what do you mean you can't figure out? Is there a way we can? He said, there's no way. Why don't you ask Vodafone to stop charging you? I said, that's a pretty bad way of doing. Then he went to Vodafone. They said, no, we can't stop it because you gave the mandate to bank. So you have to go to the bank and cancel it. I think the paperwork is sort of a feel good factor. Actually, people really feel good in the system that we took a lot of paper and took a lot of system, a lot of signature, really don't know what to do with it. And there's no real reasoning behind why so many papers exist and so on. But there's reasoning. The reasons are actually accumulated over decades. I think that is the trouble which we face when we start doing electronic system. The first generation electronic systems are actually simply imitating. So we have extremely complex rules, you know, whether you are registering a property, I mean, akrama, sakrama, and everything that we do is all the mess that we do because of nobody really knows what the rules are. And the rules can be interpreted very easily. It's very interesting point is that almost all government services are location locked or non-agnostic. That means I have to forcefully, if I have to change my driver's license, I have no other place to go but electronic city RTO. because I live in the electronic city RDO, that actually means that I have no choice but to go to that officer who is sitting there to get that signature done. So why? We have to ask why. And very interestingly, they have electronified, or what do you call, digitized the system. So you can actually apply on paper and they'll type it in into the system. But you still need to go through the same process that I have to go there, ask that person. The person will say, no, it's not time. You come in. And I personally, I said, okay. While I had some contacts in RTO, I said, I didn't want to try. I wanted to change my address, and I went there. And I had to stand in line for paying fees, which I could have paid online easily, right? At least we had opportunity to pay online, but they didn't give me an opportunity. I said, stand in line. And he looked up and said, you're too late. I said, no, you said 2 o'clock and I'm here before 2. He said, it's a very busy day, come on another day. Because he had all this vehicle registration going on and he had a pile next to him. So understandably so, maybe he has a lot of work, and maybe that's where his main work is, okay? He was uninteresting. I mean, he didn't want to take my 270 rupees for that smart card. He said, no chance. So this problem of location locking comes from a fundamental fact that there was no traditionally, when you, same thing with the ration shops or fair price shops. You go to a shop, you have to go to the same shop. You have to go to the same ward to vote. So you have to go to the same, you know, place to do the same thing, because that's how they identified you. That's how they applied the rules that you actually picked up to this month's rice. And you can't pick it up twice. Today's rice or this month's rice or sugar came. It was a human being who was actually applying those rules, and a human being recognizing you said, hey, you have already come, so you can't take it again. When they digitized, they simply digitized the same process. So they typed all that thing into the computer, but you have to do the same thing. You wonder, why do you want to go to the same shop, right? Nobody is asking basic fundamental question. Second thing is, because of this, you leave a lot of discretion to the people. So that officer who is sitting there has all the discretionary power to do either to help you or to screw you, whatever he wants to do, okay? So you can completely play around with that human being pretty easily, because you know what? Rules are interpretable. You don't have a choice. You have to go to the same place. And immediately helping discretionary decision making. And complete lack of analytics or transparency of the whole process. But when we did technology usage, the first thing government did was to automate exactly the same process. That's what I call it first generation. First generation was a simple automation of an existing process which did nothing to convenience, nothing to choice, nothing to make it easy. It just made it probably even harder, I think. Because now you have to fill forms and you have to still also have a person type it in, and whoever typed it in not sure whether what is in the form, and you have to now match it. So you have more work over. Somebody has created a lot of BPO. Income tax, we were working with income tax in the last 3 months. Income tax is trying to use Aadhaar authentication for during filing. So when you file the thing, you have to print it out and sign and send it to Electronic City, right? There's a bunch of guys sitting around and scanning these papers, and somebody is matching, and it's 100 rupees per page. BPO activities, 100 rupees per page spent, and you spend 20 rupees. And last year they lost my paper, or my accountant lost, I'm not sure who lost it. I got a reminder saying that your paper has not come. So I had to print it out again and send it back again. Now they're trying to do is like that if you Aadhaar authenticated, then you don't have to print. So they're trying to do some of that thing. But really what's happening is that they were simply creating more work by electronifying rather than simplifying. But the second generation, we are actually in the second generation. I think I just called it second generation because now people are, in the last decade, people have said, okay, maybe I'll give a self-service, like a property tax in Bangalore. Very convenient. You can go to online, you enter your property ID, it just fills up all the information. You just, you know, if you have a capability to pay, and most people find it still hard to pay online, but still, people who have capability to pay at least find it convenient, okay? And people who have to deal with paperwork and office, you still harder. But what really did the difference is that third bullet I think that's the key to platformification. That government today builds entire application as a holistic, fully functional vertical app. They don't say, you can build an app and you can build an app and all of you can build an app if I had only made that platform, right? Instead, they would actually put out an RFP. Like that BBMP, when the president came and did the inauguration of M-Governance or one of those apps, some 200 odd apps or something. How many are being used? Very few. And most of the time that BBMP or BMTC, the bus app, if you use, it'll say bus not found, driver not found and all that thing, all those errors. And you just wonder, what if bus not found? I can see buses going, you know, it must be there somewhere in the database, find it, no. But you know what's hard? I've been part of the RFP process in the last 5 years. It is damn hard for the government to say, I will build an app. Now you will give some feedback on the application. He'll say, oh, I want button. I have not put this in the RFP, these features. So how will I pay this vendor for these changes? So you can only do 20% change request maximum. CVC guidelines exist. So you can only do so much money extra. Somebody would have anyway undercut the whole RFP, okay? Somebody would have said, I'll do it for 2,000 rupees. And they'll say, okay, you won because you are the L1. You're the least, you know. Nobody can do anything in 2,000 rupees, right? So you, anyway, starting point is so low that you are not going anyway. Our real point should have been, what if BMTC had put out the data as open data and available GPS locations at open data or open API? Apps outside, like Google Map or your own app, could have integrated that data and provided much more richer features, because you have an incentive to do that and you will have a product to do that and you have a business model around to do that and you can continue to improve. But they don't think that way. They are trying to build the whole thing. But there are this good news. I think it's really good news, at least at the center level. The good news, there are some massive big platforms are coming. And I want you to be really understanding them, because maybe you could be incubating out products for those platforms. Okay, so some of them I know, company works on micro ATM on Aadhaar and all that thing, right? So that's already a part of it. But there are a few more I want to talk about. So this rigidity of the whole application, when you create a vertical complete functionality, it's a bad idea, because you never know what the functionality is going to be, and you never know what new mobile devices are going to come. You never know what new front end innovation is going to happen. Government cannot deal with it. Okay, they should not build any of this. They should build a simple open data or open API platforms, right? But what is a platform? So it's actually time for all of us to influence, and whoever in the system, outside the system, to influence the government to say, stop putting out RFPs for apps. Only build bare minimum in the system, so that outside layers of functionality can be built by many other. If you look at MasterCard or Visa, it's all layered architecture that way, right? All they do is this, then they are acquiring, issuing architecture there, and then acquiring architecture to connect through that system, and the banks actually issue the card, we use it in the merchants. MasterCard is not owning the whole thing as a single application, and they don't create or put RFP to buy devices. They let the vendors build that, right? So it's a good example of some of that. And it's very, very key for us to do. So what's a platform? I think there is a very, very good, well-defined architectures about platform, which talks about why platform has to be generalized. That means it is other way around. Thinking is not complete functionality. It's a minimum functionality, but very, very generalized core features in there. Extremely minimally function. It's hard to do. If you are also building, you will be tempted to build all kinds of features into your product. I ran product companies for like 2 decades. You have to do what's called a multi-generation, multi-version. You have to grow into it based on feedback. And if your product hat is not, you know, helping you do that, then you're overcomplicating. And for government especially, when you do these platforms within the system, it should be extremely minimally functional, not complicated at all. Because we have to ask every question. Why do we need that functionality here? Could somebody else who is actually building a product on top of this platform, can they build that functionality? Then leave it to them. It's very hard. It's very hard for decision makers to say, no, I'll write the whole thing myself, right? And it's extremely difficult to be minimal. I think it's difficult to be minimal for all of us. I think it's difficult for the system. Ecosystem driven. They have to embrace. They should not put RFP. What happens is when you put RFP, none of the product startups here can actually bid for it today. Because government RFPs do not let any of the startups to bid. Because it's too risky for them. Because you are actually procuring. They like procurement. They should not procure anything, according to us. They should let that innovation be outside. But procurement mindset and system integrator mindset is what's caused this issue. But desperately trying to change that mindset now to say, don't procure. Embrace ecosystem. Let there be multiple vendors or multiple product companies who are using your platform. There is no reason to restrict. And layerable. It's a very, very interesting concept. So minimalistic talk about only one functionality, but that functionality, it does very, very well. Then another functionality layered on top. And then sometimes the government system, within the system, we should say, no, we are building only the basics and you have let product companies outside build and I will empanel or allow certify, like, you know, visa certified sort of thing. You could have certified apps and all of you could be actually selling apps which is actually connected and helping a particular set of society. You know, because nobody can dominate the whole system. Nobody can assume that I'll take care, you know, own the whole country. So you are always have to work, but that has to be plugged into something larger so that the people have that choice. And the payments are actually a good example of this. And providing choice at the end, I think choice for people, I think that even it's harder for us to figure it out. Choice is for the people, choice of apps, choice of channels, choice of where I want to do, choice of when I want to do, choice of how I should be paying you, all that is a choice. And the more you choice you give it to people, the less front-end, what's called a retail corruption, actually starts diminishing. Because that there is no more discretionary decision-making at the front. So intelligence is actually moving to the platform. And front-ends are just, you know, nice interfaces that product companies build and all driven off the API at the back. This is a very well-studied architecture and some of you would have actually surely looked at it. It's called an hourglass architecture. How government systems should be studied in Harvard. Many other systems there actually study about this. Where the government should be actually right at the middle of the hourglass. Not the fat part. Most thin, lean part of the hourglass where government should build systems. And this is a great example of an hourglass architecture. How all IP packet did is only to carry one packet of data. But look at the way softwares are layered on top of that and hardware architecture is layered in. And this innovation just took off because it had no affinity or no location. Otherwise, what will happen? You'll get a cylindrical shape. And so you should actually think when you say platform, is government building a platform? You have to ask that question. How is this actually an hourglass architecture where you are doing minimalistic, you are there and you are allowing innovations, layers of innovation on top of it. This is a integrated chip is one example. Who knew that one integrated chip could be stacked like crazy and you could do the most powerful computer in our pocket? You know, today, right? All kinds of innovation, set-top boxes, or even these ones, they're all microchip-based, right? Or everything is now microcontroller-based. So it's amazing that one innovation can actually allow openness without thinking through the whole thing. That is why. And platforms cultivate innovation. I think that is very, very key. And product startups and the next wave in India, when we see the product startups, the only way, especially social startups, commercial startups are easier in one sense because, you know, there is a social startups are even harder because you have to work with the government system. And India is, you cannot be outside them. It's very hard. Okay. And you have to be embracing and they have to embrace you. Otherwise, it doesn't happen. It'll make an impact, a small impact. It will not make a larger impact. Okay. And we have been advocating for doing platform play for the government, and I have some few examples for that. And one of them is Aadhaar, and we started this in 2009 was when Nandan was called in by Dr. Manmohan Singh. 2010 we launched, and we are at 850 million Aadhaar holders today, and we are going to reach a billion this year. So a billion people are actually in the country walking around with digitally verifiable identity. That can be, they can make an identity claim who they are and establish that they are indeed who they claim to be to the system. Because systems, everything work on identity. In the sense, any system, you go to property tax, who are you? Bank, who are you? You know, driver's license, who are you? Do you want pension, who are you? You know, are you alive? And these are the questions that constantly that people are battling. And people who migrate in our country, when because of large opportunity, job opportunity, people who move, they just lose their identity otherwise. They lose the identity that they were actually in that village. So this is a portable, national, purely digital. Actually, that letter that you get is irrelevant. Okay, so either you have to ignore what you have. You can actually remember the number. That's good enough. And other side, that is why when we built it, so much of pressure we had in 2009, three NVITEL committee. We sat through the committee and we had all the bureaucrats, very senior people, home ministry and finance ministry and so on, people representing. And they're saying, you are going to touch, literally touch, because we were taking biometrics, you know. We are going to touch literally 1 billion or 1.2 billion, nobody knows the count anyway, 1.2 billion people in this country. While you are at it, you can ask few more questions. They were so tempted to add few more attributes. Is it add caste, you know, religion, income level, how much they have studied, whether they have a cycle or a goat at home or a cow, you know, whatever. Just ask few more questions. Anyway, you're going to make people stand in line. 1 billion people are going to stand in line, right? For us in the next 4 years. Ask few more questions, no? What's the big deal? While you are at it, collect the data. We had to fight that battle. You can't believe how much we had to fight. And we have four attributes. That's all we have. Name, date of birth, gender, address. And optionally mobile number because of the authentication. That's all we have. We removed everything. The hardest to remove was two things. Husband or father's name. That was a battle. Okay. First of all, is why husband? Why not wife's name? Okay, or why not mother's name? Then we asked, what happened to orphans? Or what happened to people who are homeless, who have no recollection? Of course, they'll cook up some father's name. Then what will happen? How do I know that's your father? Now go get a paper from magistrate. Get a paper from that. That's exactly what the harassment is all about. That's the fun part, no? About making people run around, you know? So we said no. We said, we even removed relationship because we had nothing. We said, if the purpose of the identity, purpose is to give a unique identity to an individual, irrespective of their, you know, father is there, mother is there, married, not married. Marriage was another problem, which we didn't want to take on because it was even a harder problem, right? And then we said, that's all you need. They should be able to get, and second purpose was people who don't have identity today. They are not on the social grid. So they are outside the social grid because society is not recognizing. Social systems like pension and, you know, food distribution systems don't recognize them. If you have to give that to them, even more important not to complicate life. Because if you complicate, then they are all the same people who will get excluded, right? Even with this, it's hard on the ground. Okay, even with four attributes, people harass you, right? They find a way to do something, I think. Even we hear horror stories for Aadhaar camps, but anyway, we have reached 850 million, not so bad. You know, and there's all unique identity, and we will reach now, you know, new government has embraced it really well. And the system has scaled really well. And again, I think when we designed, people said at that time, biometric matching was unproven in the sense that it was proven only to 120 million. That was the largest biometric based system. We were doing 1.2 billion, 10 times, right? So they said, you will need all the computers in the world, literally, to put together. It'll be so damn expensive, it won't be economically viable to do this. All we have is 3,000 square feet of data center. It's like an apartment. 4,000 blade servers, that's all we have. We run it because of the openness of the system and most importantly, simplicity of the system. We kept it really, 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 really simple. If you complicate, nothing comes out, right? Okay, I think there was some questions, but we'll wait, if you don't mind, okay. And what are the innovation? That is, I'm going back to that platform thinking. At the bottom, we had suddenly India, now we have biometric as an authentication factor. OTP is a factor, right? What you have. Mobile is what you have. And PIN and passwords are all what you know. And biometric is what you are or who you are. And the biometric is a way to prove that, right? So now a combination of these factors is what work for various authentication. Depends on the risk of the authentication, depending on risk. If you're transferring large amount of money or walking into nuclear with for the red button, you better be careful, okay? You can't do simple biometric or OTP and also, okay, now you press the button. You know, the nuclear thing, no? Okay. But so people ask, can biometric? No, we said, okay, take it easy, it's all right. So sometimes you have to, you know, make sure that you design the risk mitigation comes from the, how you design the system. It's only just a factor. It just allows you to identify you. You can do all kinds of more things layered on top of. So at the bottom, we have sensors. Suddenly, when we started, we had an open API for everything. We did not go procure. By the way, Aadhaar system procured no hardware outside. So all the cams you see are we bought. We had 150 people and we had, you know, some of us volunteering in the system. But really, we bought no computers outside at all. No laptops, nothing. Ecosystem did that. So ecosystem partners actually brought that and they got the ROI because they were paid based on successful generation of Aadhaar. Not successful enrollment. Successful generation of Aadhaar. We paid money. Because you can't cook up under the tree and say Ramlal, Lakshmanlal and all, you know, and then say these are all real people. Because we have to deduplicate them, right? So we have to really say these are real people, biometrically deduplicatable, and hence we pay them 40 rupees. Okay, that was a sort of identified rate at that time. Interesting point I was saying is that when we started and we had 3.2 lakhs that the kit cost, not for us, for the person who was setting up the camp, it cost one laptop biometric. Less than 9 months, it came down to 1.7 lakhs and now it's actually less than a lakh. Not because the technology laptop prices crashed, because there were multiple vendors competing for the same who are certified, competing in the market now. Suddenly there's a market for biometric sensors, right? So more people are competing, more vendors are coming. They get certified and say, I will give you, I'll set up a factory in Chennai or wherever and make it cheaper and cheaper. It's a choice that you get. And on the same, by the way, mobile biometric is coming on the mobile. There are two companies who are going to launch iris sensor right on the mobile. It's less than $3. 180 rupees. That's all it costs to put iris on the mobile. And people are putting it. And you will see sub 10,000 rupee smartphones, Android phones with biometric very, very soon in India. And all this we are not doing, actually. Micro ATMs are being built. And on the other side, the basic feature of e-sign is a digital signature based on Aadhaar. Completely done by DATI, CCA, Controller of Certification Authority. They are building that API. Aadhaar is not building that API. Aadhaar-based payment bridge allows someone to send money to an Aadhaar number without knowing where their account is. Portability of financial account. So Aadhaar has a financial address. That's how LPG, all the subsidies now coming, because they know your Aadhaar number lifelong. It's the same number. I just have to pay you. You can actually pay salary. People are paying salary through that now. All you have to do is send money. No, PF is going to be moved, because PF and all we have seen, right? It's hard. Because they just don't port with you. It's not portable. You run around trying to get them. But this is not done by us. This is done by NPCI, National Payment Corporation. This is done by another layer above that. And many apps are being set up, all done by outside. And it's not done by Aadhaar at all. None of these are known to Aadhaar. We are only encouraging them to build. We don't know anything else. And there are a few more examples like this. You payment guys, if you are into payment, you should look at a new specification called Unified Payment Interface from NPCI. Brilliant interface which allows any to any money transfer, any to any immediate money transfer, and is completely API based. That means you can build potentially you can think of building something on a set top box that allows you to pay by, you know, doing something on the TV with the remote. Literally, you can, because it's form factor agnostic and so on. And another one is very important one I want to talk about is goods and services tax. You won't believe that US, it was very hard for us to believe too. Goods and services, I'm on the advisory board for GST and both NPCI and advisory board for GSTN, which is the technology arm for GST rollout in the country. Completely API based. It was a decision that we were so surprised that they embraced it. They said, build GST as an API, not as a portal. They were trying to build the whole GST as a portal application. That means somebody will log in, file income tax, everything. And we think, why would you not let Tallies of the world or any Clear Tax or any other product company, let's say you are building a mobile app for an SME, small, medium company, and you want to provide that, you should be able to, via API, you should be able to let your customer file taxes completely API-based. Why should they log in to the portal? Anyway, the login portal is going to look like IRCTC problem. And finally, everybody will log in on the same day, last day of the tax, and it will come down. So we said, don't even attempt. Then they're building that. And actually now, next to next month, we are arranging, Bangalore is a place for all the product startups. So GSTN is arranging actually a product ecosystem launch, where we are bringing product companies and say, build to this API, because we don't have a user interface. You will provide that user interface to your customers. It could be a retail system, POS systems, and so on. It's very critical. It was a very powerful way to think how the platform can come. So really, in summary, we are saying that government, when you build, unless the government builds it as a platform and not as an app, product startups, social startups cannot exist successfully. You can exist, it'll be a struggle. But digital startups cannot exist. You can, physical other products and all might exist, like solar lamps and so on, you might still happen. But finally, government has to embrace that, provide a platform for you to plug in your product, and you support a set of people behind the scene as your customer, right? That cannot work otherwise. And it has to embrace ecosystem to innovate. And finally, given the choice and simplicity, I should have a choice which tax system I should use. You know, it's my choice. But it all goes into the same system. Build in the rules, no big deal. Why do I have to fill the same printed form? It doesn't make any sense, right? And most importantly, I think the entire data, we are asking what's called a data exhaust, like a car exhaust. We are saying that all these platforms are going to provide data exhausts. Anonymized, of course, privacy respected, because you can't put private data. But both National Payment Corporation of India and GSTN will provide open data exhaust, on which you can still do research and build and really know how many people in what areas, what is a typical tax collection, and what's going on, and so on. Or as data, not as a PDF report. That's the difference. Okay, it's just as the data. I think that's about it. All right, that's all I wanted to talk to you about. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Varma. Now we have a panel discussion on the topic, opportunities and challenges in civic tech startup space. May I request Professor Srikanth to introduce the panelists and moderate the session.
Thank you, Pramod, for that wonderful talk. Let's hope that things go the way you're talking, and we'll have many more of the startups soon, you know, being able to leverage all this data to provide useful apps for us. This kind of fits in with the theme of what we are talking about today. Is, as I said earlier, from I-MACX perspective, we are looking at in the accelerator specifically, is looking at encouraging companies, startups, enterprises that are looking at social, civic tech causes. And while there are a lot of opportunities, there are lots of challenges. And what we thought we'd look at in this session is some of the challenges and opportunities for civic tech startups as they go forward in their innovative journey. And so there are two sides to it. There are, the opportunity side, you know, the government and other organizations you have to deal with, but there are a lot of challenges that come up on that. There are the underserved groups who are not served very well today, and the challenge is how to reach them and how to actually get your solutions out so that these people can actually benefit from it. And for startups especially, the other important part is, how do they get all this funded? They're very different from the commercial startups, and it's not clear that the path they can take or should take will be the same. So how do they structure their business? How do they design their products, their business plans? How do they go to market? All that needs to be different. So we put together a panel of experts or experienced people from this field, looking at kind of the different angles and perspectives of this. We have people from the investment community, people who have worked in the government, worked with data in the government, you know, people are running social organizations and actually putting out or doing the kind of apps that we want to talk about. So it's my, we're hoping that between them and during the discussion, we'll bring out perspectives that will help the startups and future startups that we are going to look at. So I'll briefly introduce each of the panelists and request them to come up here as we go forward. I'd like to welcome first Radha Kizhanattam, who's a principal at the Unitus Seed Fund. Radha has deep operational. Radha has deep operational experience in building and commercializing technology products for the global markets. And as a member of the screening committee at Mumbai Angels, Radha helped evaluate and make early stage technology venture investments. She's also a mentor at NSRCL at IIM Bangalore. And previously she did marketing at Gupshup, a mobile space startup. She has a master's in computer science from NITK and an MBA from IIM Bangalore. And we are very pleased to have you here, Radha.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'd like to next welcome Shyam Menon. Shyam is an investment director at Infuse Ventures. By the way, both Radha and Shyam have spent time with our accelerator companies already, so they're familiar and to each other, but we're hoping that the larger group here will also benefit from their ideas. Shyam has over a dozen years experience in the energy sector, focusing in including investment management roles at Conduit Ventures, a corporate-backed early-stage energy venture capital fund in London, and Nadathur Holdings. He has worked at the World Bank, working on carbon finance methodology, techno-economic analysis of energy use in India and China, and was a member of the China Energy Group at Lawrence Berkeley National Lab in California. He holds a master's in material engineering from the University of Missouri, a bachelor's in metallurgical engineering from NIT Nagpur, and advanced energy policy studies from the University of California. Welcome, Shyam. Mr. Sunil Abraham, I'd like to welcome Sunil to our panel. So I didn't meet him earlier, so welcome, Sunil. So Sunil is the executive director of the Center for Internet and Society. He's also a social entrepreneur and a free software advocate. He founded Mahiti in 1998 with the aim to reduce the cost and complexity of information and communication technology for the voluntary sector by using free software. I will let him speak a little more about what all he works on as part of the questions, but Sunil is elected an Ashoka Fellow in 1999 to explore the democratic potential of the internet and was granted a Sarai Floss Fellowship in 2003. He's the co-author of many publications on topics ranging from unlicensed spectrum to open data and digital natives. Welcome. I'd like to welcome Rajith Shaji. Rajith is a product manager at Janaagraha, and you know their apps, I Change My City and others, are kind of the showcase or role model apps we would like to look at in these kinds of settings. He has experience leading design, development, and marketing of mobile, desktop, and browser-based products. He's contributed to the success of several startups over the course of his career. He believes in creating compelling user experiences to thrill the users. He started his consultancy at TCS and worked at a startup before moving into his current role at Janaagraha. And he has experience working on commerce and on governance and social technology. Welcome, Rajith. And finally, I'd like to welcome our own V.S. Prakash. I'll move this. So Prakash is currently the registrar of IIIT-B. Before that, he was director and retired as the director of the Karnataka State Natural Disasters Monitoring Center, which is an autonomous body affiliated with the Department of Science and Technology in the government of Karnataka. He is trained as a postgraduate in Earth Sciences from Central College, Bangalore, a postgraduate in Exploration Physics, Geophysics from Osmania University, Hyderabad, and in postgraduate in Water Resources with specialization in Remote Sensing, GIS, in the International Institute for Aerospace and Earth Sciences in the Netherlands. He has served in various capacities in the Government of India and Government of Karnataka since 1973, and he brings with us a lot of experience in dealing with data in the government context on the parallel to what Pramod was just talking about. So we look forward to his perspective on some of these things. We had a sixth panelist, but unfortunately he got held up in a meeting and couldn't come here. So we will get started with these panelists that we have here. So what I'll do is maybe just to see, ask a couple of kind of leading questions and really let them take it the way they would like. So maybe since most of the attendees, the startups especially, would be interested in the funding side of things, they feel they've cracked most of the other things. So maybe, Radha, you could start with how, and since your organization looks at these kinds of companies and funds them, maybe you can just start by setting the context, saying how you look at civic startups differently from other startups, what you would consider measures of success and so on, and then maybe we'll jump over and come back to you later.
Sure.
Thank you.
So great to be here again. Professor Srikanth mentioned, I was here and I met all of the startups that have been incubated here. It was really exciting. I don't think as a fund we look at city startups differently from other startups we evaluate. I think investors, obviously financial investors, are only keen on investing in for-profit startups which are going to give them X amount of returns. You can say we want to look for 10x returns in 5 to 7 years. And we as a fund very strongly believe that there can be for-profit, sustainable, longer-term, profitable startups that can be built by serving the larger masses in India. I think what is important here is to recognize that a lot of startups that are serving the middle-income populations and the higher-income populations are actually going after a very small section or a very small segment of the larger population in India. And if you are able to innovate on your business model and if you're able to get creative and be able to provide affordable solutions and can reach these larger populations, then you can definitely build a startup that can also be financially attractive to an investor. In fact, just taking on from what Dr. Pramod was saying, I think Aadhaar is a great platform for some of the startups to really leverage, because automatically you're actually you're leveling the playing field and being able to access people who are in the lower stratas of the society. The one big learning that I think we've gained by investing in startups which are serving the larger masses is that it's not that the people in the lower income populations are not able to afford products and services. It is just that they are, you've got to provide value. You've got to be able to make it affordable in such a way that they are able to access those services. So I don't think we look at startups, civic startups, any differently. We as a fund have made about 16 investments, a couple of them in the pipeline. All of them have a speciality in the sense that the model is inclusive of the people in the larger, people in the lower income populations. So great to, I'd be interested to meet more such entrepreneurs and work with them. So.
Yeah, you can add to that.
Yeah.
So Infuse is a fund that focuses on one element of this, which is clean tech. So we look at startups in the energy, water, waste, agri, and transport sectors. So I really enjoyed Pramod's presentation. It was amazing. In fact, since we operate purely in clean tech, I hadn't yet understood the potential of others. So now you've set a lot of neurons going up here. We need to start looking at this space now. So One point that he made is very true, is that in many of our companies, there is a government element to this. Of course, we are looking for for-profit companies with a 5x, 10x return, very similar to what Unitus does. But since there's a regulatory element, one investor that we brought on board right up front was the Ministry of New and Renewable Energy. So they are the seed investor in our fund. And then we managed to raise from a lot of institutions in India and coupled from abroad, including IFC, International Finance Corporation, and BP, British Petroleum. Now, the rest of the investors are groups like ICICI Bank, Union Bank of India, Bank of India. So these are investors who have invested in our fund. So there is a strong interest in tackling problems around clean tech or sustainability in India at the investor base, but they are not willing to compromise on any return. So that is so that's the flip side of it. But the good news is we've been able to help many of our startups get through the regulatory hurdles, qualify for tender, etc. For example, we have a startup in Coimbatore that is solar water pumping for agriculture. And when the initial tender came out, the requirement was 3 years of positive cash flow for any company who's going to apply, and which startup would have that? So we ended up taking it to the Secretary of MNRE, and within 4 to 5 days, we were able to get the tender documents revised such that startups can apply, and 37 startups qualified for application and getting empaneled with MNRE. If not, there would have been 2 or 3 large corporates in India who would have qualified, and not a single startup. So just through that action, we were able to get 37 startups qualified. So we are hoping, so that engagement with MNRE is the strongest thing that we leverage. And because we have other investors like SIDB, Small Industrial Development Bank of India, what we are trying to do is try to give more confidence to these banks who are interested in investing in SMEs but are afraid of the risk and doesn't understand the startup risk. So if we evaluate and okay it as a potential investee, then they are more comfortable with lending even at slightly lower rates to some of those startups. So it is a process where they have to trust what we have done, and we have to show our credibility to these organizations before they lend. But it is coming along. So 2-3 more of our startups have been able to get some relatively slightly lower cost financing compared to the regular financing from groups like SIDBI and even Bank of India and Union Bank. So we are trying to work along those lines to see if we can help companies in the sustainability, overall sustainability sector.
I'll try and answer the question as a policy researcher, because that's what we do. And perhaps push back a little bit on constraining the definition of what is a social enterprise. Some say that social enterprises are only those that have some kind of paying business model. But I was elected a social entrepreneur in 1999, and the organization that elected me as a social entrepreneur, Shoka, has other definitions as well. And I'll talk with an example from our own organization, which is Center for Engineering Society. So the current text-to-speech engine or screen reader that's available for blind people is JAWS, and it costs $1,000 per license. And if somebody gave you $1 million, then all you could do is help 1,000 blind people use JAWS, the software. But we raised some donor funding from a foundation called Hans. They gave us, I think it was $300,000, if we look at the portion that was spent on the screen reader and text-to-speech engine. And then we basically built support for about 12 Indic languages in a free software screen text-to-speech engine called eSpeak. And then we closed, I think, 14 or 20 bucks in a free software screen reader called NVDA. So those were the two things we did. And then immediately you can see the multiplier effect of what that can potentially do in terms of users. So I wanted to talk really about market failure, because there seems to be all these opportunities, but nobody seems to be serving these opportunities. Like, even if one were to take the proprietary software paradigm, then you should have undercut JAWS, and JAWS didn't even support Indic languages. It only did Hindi and English. So somebody should have made a product, and that was a clear market opportunity, but it didn't work. So what is it the government's doing through other? And what's it that the government's doing through other policy interventions? Other is not really a capital intervention in the markets, because there's not much money involved. But as Pramod says, it is a open standards policy intervention. It is trying to unify on a standard. And no matter what the tech specifics are, when the BJP government did it with Scosta, it had a similar market impact. It brought the price of smart cards down 1/5. So it always works the same way. It doesn't matter what the specifics of the intervention are. There are huge competition benefits in the market. So to just complete Pramod's laundry list, it's not just open standards and open or free and open source software, which I think both he mentioned, and also open data. Those are all the different components of the ecosystem. But open content also is a very important piece. Like, for example, CSIR research costs us as taxpayers $500 million each year. And now that all of that output is open access, and what does that do to the market is the question that perhaps we should be asking. So on free software, we have two national policies at the moment. On open data, we have the NBSAC and projects like Radha. And on open standards, we have the national open standards policy and also the first chapter of GIF, which is the government interoperability framework. They still haven't published the data chapter, and they still haven't published the chapter for semantic interoperability. And that's like 5 or 6 years in. Just imagine the huge opportunity loss for the private sector just because the government hasn't moved on certain key enabling policy elements. So what the government is doing is shaping the market, and we're very fortunate that this government and to some extent the previous government is quite serious about this, and these are very important policies that they're putting into place. So what does it mean? Does it mean all the startups, and I completely agree that some of them should make money, should they then uncritically embrace the open paradigm? Of course not, because the sweet spot sometimes lies in between, because you have opposing imperatives such as data protection or privacy or patents. We are doing a landscaping of all patents associated with the mobile phone at the moment, and we've uncovered 42,000 patents already registered in the Indian Patent Office, and some of them in violation of the Patent Office manual. That means they're really software patents, they shouldn't have been granted. So you can imagine people trying to build, and this is just around the mobile device. So people trying to build medical devices or something, you'll run into all sorts of problems. And so it's the fine balancing act, both for the government in terms of getting it right between the proprietary and open paradigm, and then also for enterprises to do that right. So I'm not being doctrinaire about it. I think that's what should happen, and that's the big opportunity for everybody.
Thanks, Ali. Maybe Rajit will change tracks a bit, since he comes from, you know, Janaagraha and is a living example of a kind of solution that we're talking about. Maybe you can talk to us about how I Change My City has evolved. How can you actually sustain an initiative like this? I'm sure there are lots of issues in interfacing with the government, and you know, data is one part, actual operational interactions, what you guys do, and maybe you can, you know, talk about those kinds of aspects.
Okay.
And you've been running it now for 3+ years.
Right? Yeah. So Janaagraha as an organization has been around for like 15 years now. So and a part of it, like, we have two online initiatives also, IIITB and IGMSIT. So I don't know how many of you heard of both the websites, that's a different thing. But yeah, see, I think he wanted to wanted me to talk about IGMSIT. So we have our own challenges, but we don't have this challenge of, you know, making money, at least. I mean, you know, that's not our thing, you know, we just have to survive. That's our whole thing, you know. And I mean, we don't measure ourselves based on how much money we are making, but rather the impact that we are doing on the ground, that's all. And basically, you know, my boss recently heard, Omidyar, the eBay guy, tell that, you know, NGOs, you just want to do one thing, that is survive. Basically, you just have to survive, right? I mean, if you don't survive, there's no other point, right? Like, what is your existence then? So that's something that really hit her, and I think this is something that she has been putting into us also. That is, you know, we guys have to survive, and I'm sure, man, we all can survive, you know. But, you know, like, impact, I'm sure we cannot even show the impact in day one, day two. Like, IGMSIT has been around for 3 years. I'm not even sure as to how many of you have heard over here, but I'm sure we'll get there. We'll get there, you know. And as a platform, what you're trying to do in IGMSIT is, you know, mobilize the communities. Citizens should just not be, you know, armchair critics. Get out there, do something. That is all we are trying to do by IGMSIT. That is, you know, activating the citizens. That is where we are coming from. So as part of that, we have been trying very hard to people to, you know, get in post some civic issues onto our platform. We try and help these guys, you know, like, give them the numbers of the engineers who can fix this problem. We do a couple of things like this. But the hard part, like you were telling, you know, interfacing with the government is very difficult. Like Pramod just put it, you know, they don't have APIs built now. I mean, that's where they are going, right? Right now, we just take what comes. Like, example, you know, we interface a lot with BBMP. We put our problems to BESCOM, BWSSB, all these guys. We get a lot of these issues onto our platform. Every agency, we get these problems. So right now, we cannot actually even wait for the APIs to come, right? It can take years to, you know, for them to build all this stuff. So what we do is, even if it takes, you know, what is it called, sending it through Excel, do it. Do what it takes for you to, you know, interface with the government. We can't wait for them to build APIs. So that's what we have been doing at least at IIT University. Like how we have been interfacing it, and we can't even wait for formalizing of, you know, agreements. Like that is something that we have learned, you know, in dealing with government. That is recently, even with BBMP right now, we don't even have a formal agreement or an MOU signed. So that's okay. I mean, you know, you don't have to actually put it on. Like when we went to Bhubaneswar recently, we actually thought of having IIITB at Bhubaneswar. We even had a funder in place. We thought of first signing the MOU and then going and launching the site. It's been 1 year, it's been in limbo, and we never got it through. The MOU is still stuck. So we don't have to wait for all these things. You know, when there is an opportunity, just do it. You know, whatever it takes, just do it. Hey, sending Excel, and like example, you know, like with BTP, the model we follow is they are very active on Facebook. We take the complaints that come on our site, put it there, and try and you know, come back and put some result back to our users. So our whole thing is 2-3 points. That is, you know, like you have to survive. That is one thing, at least for the social space that we are in. It's a good thing that my boss is not asking me to make money out of my app. That would be very, very hard. And I have no idea how we'll even do it, because yeah, that's one problem. But the second thing is, yeah, just seize the opportunities and just go and do it. You don't have to wait for like the awesome APIs to be built or whatever it is. So these are the key learnings for me, at least from my work in Janaagraha for the two and a half years.
Give some idea of the scale of this right now. How many issues?
Okay, sorry. So some numbers, we have 1.5 lakh registered users on the site. So that is our number right now. And we have done, see, we have learned a lot. Like first 2 years, it was just like trying to find out as to what would work, right? And like what would actually make people to come about as communities, you know, like what, and what we thought, I mean, what we learned actually is complaints is what actually is, you know, bringing them together. You know, they will come out as communities and do something about it. So that is what people are interacting around in my site. So we have around 20,000 complaints, and we have a resolution rate of 50%. And trust me, 50% resolution rate is not all that bad, considering someone as Akosha, who actually, you know, deal with problems of private companies, they have a resolution rate of 68%. We have 50%. I'm happy. At least, you know, the government is not that bad when you compare it to the private guys. So yeah, but satisfaction levels, that's a totally different thing. I'm not talking about that. Like pothole problem, they just come and fill mud. You know, that's resolution. According to BBMP, that is resolution. And I'm admitting that that is resolution. You know, so that's a different thing. Okay.
Okay, thanks. So for another perspective, I think clearly any successful tech startup has to somewhere deal with government process on one side and government data on the other side itself. So maybe, Mr. Prakash, you can give us some perspectives on, since you have lived in that space, the kinds of data that are available, maybe some examples of what people have been able to do with that. I think a lot of people are not even aware of the kinds of data out there.
Thank you, Dr. Srikanth, and the previous speakers. A small correction, the way I was introduced. I'm not retired, I don't want to be called retired director, former director. Because I'm still very active. Former and retired. So, yes, I was in the government for nearly 42 years. And let me say that, you know, I have lived with startups, entrepreneurs, in my COVID job, in the field of water resources, in the field of disaster management, in the field of agriculture management, many, many issues. And I've gained out of it. I've come what others have gained. I mean, this was a win-win situation. What did I gain? I worked with startups, I got a global award for best achievement in utilizing GIS in disaster management. That was, I feel it was not possible, could not have been possible. Had I not associated myself with the entrepreneurs and the startup, number one. Number two, it requires a long-term relationship. It cannot be a business proposition, business model, as I agree with you. It can be a long-term relationship. It could be, you know, minimum 7 years or 10 years, because you have all the technology. All said and done, and the other person, he knows the field, the problem, the reality, field reality. So somewhere, it needs to be synced together, you know, understanding each other. And well, there is still a gap existing in that in that field. You take the technology. So, and to my perspective, seeking a, I make a pardon, if somebody gets offended. Decision maker, so I've been working right under the nose of decision maker. And if you ask me, were you a decision maker? Yes, I was also a decision maker. But there is a hierarchy. A decision maker, I have never seen him calling a person who is very good in technology before he makes a decision. A political system or a decision maker, they know that they cannot come to their expectation. It makes a decision because a decision needs to be taken, whether it is a chief minister, a minister, or a secretary, or a deputy commissioner, whatever it is. He can't wait for the technology to give him a solution. He has to take a decision. Many decisions are taken based on their own experience, based on the field experience which they have gained. They have got people around them, they take a decision, that's how things goes on. But here, I just coming back to Pramod ji, I agree, whatever you said, I agree with. But one thing which I can't agree or I can't understand is, almost all the startups, all the entrepreneurs, they see, they benefit from the government, but all of them criticize the government. Somehow I don't want to agree on this, I don't want to accept it. And really, even today I am searching for an answer for that. Why? Because it is very easy to criticize government, so you go on criticizing it? No. Personally, my own experience is, the society has gained a lot from the technology, what it was 10 years back, 20 years back, 30 years back. My perception is, take the health sector, yes, we have gained a lot, but still there are gaps. They are the critical issues. How we can really create a platform to address those critical issues is the main one. And they are critical. Funding is required. And maybe it is, the knowledge gap is also there. Coming to knowledge gap, my own understanding is, the people are there who can work with data. Prabhuji was also talking about data. Put the data on the, whatever people want to analyze, they should be able to. Again, data. Data, again, with the data, reliable data, accurate data, timely data, false data, cooked up data. What data you want? And cooked up data is available readily for use. You use it, develop some maps, go to the decision maker, he gets disappointed. He will never call you again. He will not call you for the decision. Then creating the data, reliable data, why it is not part of any project? To take that for granted. How? Why? I'm yet to see any project putting a cost on the data cost. I need to really create a data, and this is a data cost. And everybody, presumes that data is available, taken for granted. Cooked up data, okay. So when I say the data, say for example, disaster. A drought is there, flood is there, and now damage assessment is there. It has to come from the village level. So village secretary says, he has 20 cattle died. It comes to the tahsildar. So he says, 20, what 20? If I give 20, so MLA will be unhappy, Jilla Panchayat member will be unhappy. We'll add one more zero there. It becomes 200. So tahsildar, it comes to a state commissioner, he says, my goodness, we'll add one more zero, or we'll add some. Finally, when it comes to the CM, 20 will become 2000. So, and again they will compare with the rival, Maharashtra. Because I was in that game for a long time. Maharashtra, they have cattle 50,000 died. You have brought only 15,000 or 20,000. Please make it 50,000. So 50,000 cattle die in Karnataka also. So here, the system looked towards a technology person who is having a technology weapon to come out with the data with plus or minus 5%, 10%. That's where I have played my role. I was in that game for 15 years. And I'm very happy to say that I have gained the confidence of the administrators, political system. To the extent, that invariably I was a part of any cabinet meeting and cabinet subcommittee meeting. Maybe I was the first person who was allowed inside the cabinet talk to make a presentation in Karnataka government. I feel proud about it. And all the CMs, I had the best opportunity of being in the cabinet hall, making a presentation, because they used to depend on a person who is, so Kaveri issue for that matter. Somebody files a, nobody should get offended. So they get sharing, any government looks to whom, look around, who is going to give the data to them. So, well, there are many organizations, many universities, and you look at the type of work done in the Kaveri Basin, at least what is the flow analysis, things like that, hardly you find any paper published. Why? It is a very relevant issue, burning issue, but still nobody wants to work on that. I'm not able to understand. But more my association with the government of Karnataka, well, I used to really take fancy passion for playing with the data, things like reliable data, not good data. And again, people may ask sometimes, how did you arrive at this figure, something like that. Again, there is wisdom. Numbers plus wisdom is information. And recently my director was asking me, how much water, we are daily getting into our underground sump. I gave some number. He said, how did you get the number? I said, that is my experience, sir, that you don't. No, unless it's measured and all, it is not acceptable. I mean, he was joking with me. True. But, somewhere is the common experience. Then, the Kaveri issue, looked around, data. No. How much? Supreme Court says 10 TMC of water to be released in next 2 weeks' time. And government of Karnataka has its own predicament. Look around. I come out with saying next 2 weeks is going to rain in the downstream side of the KRS dam and whatever it is. So the water will flow to Tamil Nadu anyway. Then the system asked me, you are talking about rain, we are talking about flow. Tell me what is the volume of flow that is going to enter into Tamil Nadu. I said, okay, give me one day time. So next day morning go back, I say, we can expect about 12 TMC of water to flow in the next 2 weeks' time. No need to open our gate and release the water. Keeping our fingers crossed, next 2 weeks, 12.5 TMC of water flows at Bilibur. That's how the decision maker looks towards you, people who use technology. I think many more things can be talked about. I think I've made my points very clear. And, Pramodji, and same thing holds good to even the corporate and multinational companies also. About hospitals, the way they manage the data and they provide a service is horrible. Not only bus service. go to Columbia Asia, many hospitals is very bad. So please talk about hospitals also when you have the next opportunity. Don't criticize government alone. So and recently, there was a meeting and our director sent me an SMS and really caught in a big traffic jam near this elevated way. So what I came to, what the actual fact was, somebody, then the barcode will be there, people who buy the monthly pass.
RFID.
So I think somebody has, made a mischief with them.
It's not working.
Duplicate one they created. So they are verifying each one. So there is about a queue of half a kilometer, 1 kilometer. So you want a technology. There are good technologies, bad technologies, crooked technologies. So how to really, all these things, the government has to be very careful. They need to be protocol. So how we can help the government in really having the document, a protocol, and also deliver what is the government requires and the commentary requires. Thank you.
We talked about policy and aspects like that. A lot of what we are talking about here is solutions that are going to help underserved population. But it's also very likely that some of them will get left out in the way these are being driven, these are being implemented. So I know there's something that your organization talks about, so I'd like you to see if you can talk something about it. How do you make sure that the underserved are actually going to get served?
I'm not sure. So basically I said, if you were to look at it purely from a for-profit model, then still you could have market failure. I'm not sure that just because you shifted from a for-profit model to a non-profit model, you'll get full coverage of the market. So I don't think there's any kind of intrinsic value in doing things in a non-profit way or asking the government to inject a lot of capital into a particular set of technologies. I thought, since the success ratio when it comes to e-Gov and when it comes to incubating enterprises is roughly the same, there's a huge amount of failure, right? So 70% of everything that the government does across the world fails. So again, I wanted to underscore what Pramod said about data minimization and purpose minimization and link it to the point made about bad data. So if you don't do data minimization, so 1996, I go to North Karnataka and work for an NGO, and the donor wants to have vitals from all the patients on a daily basis, and the nurses or the auxiliary health workers tell me and my boss, either we will collect the data or we will vaccinate the children. So then my first project on Foxpro at that time was to get the data only at a weekly basis and randomize the data in between. Because I agreed, so I made this crooked technology, I agreed with the auxiliary health workers that this is the priority. Saving lives is the priority over collecting data. So if you don't take those principles, which are not his personal principles, these are principles in data protection law across the world, in all Europe-compliant data protection regimes, which is 100 markets across the world follow the European model. They have these two principles, the principle of data minimization and the principle of purpose limitation. So what I'm trying to say is those are the key parts to get it right if you want the project to succeed and if you want, therefore, to hit full mark.
So I think we're running out of time because we have a few more sessions and all of you are eagerly waiting to hear the startup. So wind up the session. Thank you all once again, Radha, Shyam, Sunil, Rajith and Prakash. Thanks for your insights and I look forward to having you back here in many different contexts. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you all. Before we go ahead with the session and the address by our special invitee and the pitches by the startup, we'll have a short tea break. The tea coffee served outside in the lobby. We expect you to be back here by 3:50. Thank you.